Hello friends, today I'm going to introduce before you Shakespeare's history play Henry VIII. Henry VIII, as we know, it was written in the year 1613, and I told this even in my last lecture when I was delivering on the epilogue to Shakespeare's The Tempest, that the epilogue is considered to be the farewell speech by many critics to Shakespeare's art, right? But then if we take The Tempest as the last play written by Shakespeare, as is claimed by many, then of course the two more plays, for example Two Noble Kinsmen and then Henry VIII, they remain rather ignored, right? So his historical accuracy there becomes flawed. So the historically accurate is, what is accurate historically is that Shakespeare wrote this play in 1613, and then we have one evidence particularly. For example, when this play was performed on 29th of June 1613 at the Globe Theater, we all know about that. So at the time it so happened that there is a particular scene in which Cardinal Wolsey, he actually gives a party to the higher class people, right, where many earls, they go there. And at the same time, we also know that it was Henry VIII who also goes there in a disguise, right? Now why I'm talking about it in the very beginning of the of my lecture, it is because when he went there at the time, it was not believed initially that it was Henry VIII. So of course it comes to be known later on when Cardinal Wolsey finds out that it is His Majesty, that is King Henry VIII. Now friends, what I want to tell here is that when the play was performed in 1613, right? So when this particular scene, it was acted out on the stage, right? So there cannons were actually fired. Cannon were fired in order to welcome King Henry VIII, right? King Henry VIII that is in that performance, right? So it is at the time that one of the cannons, it accidentally, right, touched the roof. Now roof at that time, they were not cemented, but they were made of thatch, right? So the roof was thatched one. Right, so it is because of that thatched roof, it got fire, right? And it is because of this fire then that the whole of the Globe Theater, it burnt down in less than an hour. I mean, it did not take even half an hour for this Globe Theater to actually burn down completely. So that is something that I wanted to begin on this note in order to I'm not saying I'm proving, but in order to support my claim that Henry VIII was probably written in 1613, right friends? And then why? Because many critics, they have doubted that whether Henry VIII was written by one person or two persons. Was there one writer or were there two writers, right? So these particular critical interventions, they begin to appear especially in the 19th century. And as far as these things are concerned, so we find that it was Alfred Lord Tennyson, right, who was the first person actually to doubt the single authorship of Henry VIII, right? So Tennyson, why did he come up with this conclusion? So what he said was that in a way, as far as the metrical pattern metrical pattern of Shakespeare's Henry VIII is concerned, so it does not match with the previous plays written by William Shakespeare. So it was for this reason that Shakespeare's authorship, right, of Henry VIII was doubted for the first time, right? Now, the second thing that we find to this is Alfred Lord Tennyson had a friend whose name was John Spedding, right? Now, John Spedding, he gave much air to the views expressed by Shakespeare, right? Tennyson, right? And what he said there was that he talked about that there are only a few scenes. For example, he did talk about Act 1, and then Act 1, Scene 1, Scene 2, then Act 2, Scene 3, Scene 4, then he went to Act 3, Scene 2, and then he also went to Act 5, right? Act 5 and Scene 1. And what he said was that except these six scenes, rest of the play actually was written by, that is, someone else, and that someone else here was Fletcher, right, friends? Another important dramatist who came on the English scene. He was a contemporary of Shakespeare only, but then he was younger than him and he came on the English stage. Both of them, in a way, they were working, let us say, together, right? And then, it was after William Shakespeare that Fletcher, the playwright, came on the scene, and then he became the chief writer for the Kingsman, right? So that is one of the reasons. Now see, John Spedding, what he said was that much of the play has actually feminine ending, or much of the, what you call it, blank verse is end stopped. Right now, when Spedding said that most of the verses were feminine, had feminine ending, so that feminine ending meant the last line of the play, that is, of one particular verse, right, it ended on, or a dialogue, it ended on what we call it, a feminine ending, right? Feminine ending on an unstressed syllable. So feminine rhyme or feminine ending is different from the masculine ending. So feminine ending, it does end on, let us say, an unstressed syllable, and this masculine ending, it actually ends on a stressed syllable, right? So it is what he pointed out at that time. Now, in a way, he presented a case, apart from Tennyson, even Fletcher, he presented this case for what we call it, a joint authorship, right? But then, if we talk about that Shakespeare wrote this play single-handedly, or he was the sole author. Now, we did talk about that there were some arguments which convey or which throw light that it was written by two people. But then, if we talk about that it was, the case is in favor of Shakespeare, then perhaps we would believe that it was only Shakespeare who wrote the play, on his own, single-handedly. Now, the very first thing that I think becomes important here is, if we look at the farewell speeches. Now consider there are three farewell speeches given in the play. There is first farewell speech, which is given by Buckingham, if you know. Second farewell speech is given by Cardinal Wolsey, right? And third farewell speech that we have with us, it is by Catherine, that is Queen Catherine herself. So it is in these three farewell speeches that the whole dramatic, if we call it, dramatic quality, right, it lies. And if we say that Shakespeare did write only those six scenes, right, as John Spedding was claiming earlier, right? And the way he was saying, the rest was written by a Fletcher, John Fletcher. So it makes, it robs Shakespeare actually of all the merits that he displayed in those farewell speeches. Why? Because we do not find Fletcher actually coming closer to that kind of merit, to that kind of quality, to that kind of dramatic excellence that we find in these farewell speeches, especially in Henry VIII, right, friends? So that is the first case that is in favor of Shakespeare. Why? Because Shakespeare has earlier also produced, I mean, such dialogues or such sparkling dialogues, right? Which we find that Fletcher has nowhere done, right, friends? So this is one of the arguments that is that we can look for. And second is, for example, that after Shakespeare, it was Fletcher who became actually the chief writer for the Kingsman, right? I hope you all know, or we know, that the Shakespeare's company, it came to be known as the Kingsman after King James I. He became the monarch in 1603, right? So thereafter, they came to be called, this theatrical troupe came to be called as the Kingsmen. And what I'm telling is that after Shakespeare, earlier Shakespeare was the primary writer, right? So, and at that time as well, Fletcher was also there. He was also working in the same company, Kingsmen, right? But here, after Shakespeare, it was Fletcher who came the chief writer. So mind you that when we say that most of the style that we find in Henry VIII, it seems to be Fletcherian in style, right? So it is because Shakespeare might have known about the style of Fletcher, right? As a consequence of, or as a result of, that both men were writing at the same time, nearly at the same time, or when Shakespeare was writing, he was familiar with the other writer who had to occupy the same seat that he had occupied there earlier, that is becoming the chief writer for the Kingsman. So that again goes in the favor of course Shakespeare. And third is that Shakespeare's style, it changed significantly or dramatically during his last years, right, friends? So if you look at his last years, so there we find that as far as the audience is concerned, so the audience there was more sophisticated, the audience was more intellectual, and at the same time the plays were being performed, especially at the Blackfriars. I told you why at the Blackfriars, because in 1613 this Globe Theatre had burned down, and as far as Blackfriars was concerned, the Blackfriars was a roofed in roofed in theatre, and there only mostly high class audience would be a part of the performance, right? They would be allowed there to watch the performance. Why? Because they had to pay for the tickets as well, right? So that makes it a bit different, this play. Why? Because perhaps he had this thing in mind that the play would be performed at the Blackfriars, maybe, or other thing is that the audience will be more sophisticated. So that again may be one of the reasons why there is that change in style, right, for which Shakespeare is set. It is said that Shakespeare is not the sole author. So another reason is that as well. Then friends, next thing that we find is that it was only in the 19th century that literary critics, they started to intervene concerning the sole authorship of Shakespeare, right? So if we ask this case, if we take this further, why not in his own time? Why not during the own time of Shakespeare that such criticism began to come there? Not criticism exactly, but let us say it was being said that that even Fletcher also contributed to Henry VIII. So if you look at Shakespeare's The First Folio, I told you earlier as well, it was published in the year 1623. Understand one thing very clearly here, two noble kinsmen. Mind you, two noble kinsmen. It was not included, this play was not included in the first folio of Shakespeare in 1623. The reason being that it was jointly written and the editors had evidence regarding that, and that is why they did not include two noble kinsmen, right? But then why did they include Henry VIII? The reason being that they very well, that is verified, right? That it was written only by Shakespeare. So that is again another case which goes in Shakespeare's favor, that the editors, when they included Henry VIII under the sole authorship of Shakespeare, so they very well knew that he was the sole author of the play, right, friends? And another thing is, some people say that there is lack of unity in Henry VIII. Now the lack of unity may be because Henry VIII was taken so much so by these directors to perform, right? And then there were people who were eager to play the roles which were played by Cardinal Wolsey, then Henry VIII, and then even Catherine, right? So the space was being given to many actors who were coming there, or when the play was being adapted, right? Or even when the play was being staged, right? So it is because of this that, I mean, there might have been that lack of unity, but then it does not have that lack of unity, although critics say that. And it is the reason that you also find that there are also cuts in Act 4 and Act 5. You go to Act 5 and you find that some people, they club their two scenes together, Scene 3 and Scene 4, or Scene 2 and Scene 3, and somewhere you find that Scene 3 is completely missing from the 5th act. So that the reason being, one of the reasons can be, as I told you, that there were these many productions of Henry VIII, I mean, throughout these centuries, especially 19th, 18th, and even 20th century, right? Next thing that I think becomes important here is that if you look at Shakespeare, during his later years, Shakespeare turned to tragicomedy, right? Tragicomedy as well as romances, right? So what does it demand from you is a sort of hilarious mood, right? So let us say Shakespeare was in a way experimenting, right? He was experimenting here, and when I mean, that can also be one of the reasons that you do not find the same kind of unity or same kind of cohesion that we find in the earlier writings, earlier plays of Shakespeare. Right, then friends, next thing is, what was the purpose of Shakespeare in writing a history play? Shakespeare wrote nearly 10 history plays, and then I think the first play that came from Shakespeare, if I'm not mistaken, it was King John, and the last play is King Henry VIII that we are talking about recently. So after 1599, if he had given up writing Henry plays, I think he wrote nearly 6 to 7 plays Henry's even. And then if we talk about this play, so it was written in 1613, and the last history play that he wrote was in 1519. So the question is, what was the purpose that when he left writing history plays in 1599, why did he turn to writing history plays now again, a history play now in 1613, right, friends? And if you look at it, why such a religious play, right? Or why such a religiously controversial play, right? Because it is Henry VIII's decision to divorce Catherine, which is considered to be as a catalyst, right? In letting England move from a Catholic nation to a Protestant one. Now, mind you, I'm not saying England became a Catholic nation during Henry VIII's rule. That is not the case, right? I'm not saying that. It did not become a Protestant nation during Henry VIII's rule, but, right, the milestone, the first step was taken during that time only, right? So why did he turn to such a controversial subject at that time, right? And at the same time, if you look at it, you can again say that, for example, that why there happens to be, for example, such an anticlimax. Now, when you read the play, do you believe that the play would end on such a note? Have you read any of the, let us say, tragedies of Shakespeare or history plays of Shakespeare which do not end in death, bloodshed, right? We do not find that any of Shakespeare's history plays, especially, they do end in death and bloodshed, right? And here as well, Henry VIII, if you look at it, here in Henry VIII, we find that the play actually does not end in death here, right? So we do not find a climax as we do find in other plays of Shakespeare, history plays of Shakespeare, but rather we have an anticlimax here. Now see, there are many important characters who die. Buckingham dies, right? Queen Catherine dies, Cardinal Wolsey dies, and then we expect for something more that is dramatic, right? But then the play does not end in bloodshed, but then it does end on some different note. And what is that different note? It is that the play ends with the birth of Queen Elizabeth. Right, friends? Why with the birth of Queen Elizabeth, right? Again, the point is that Shakespeare was experimenting in, let us say, tragedy, comedy, and romance, right? So it may be one of the reasons that we find that there is, it is because of this that he is doing there, right? And then there is a mask-like entertainment as well, mask-like entertainment. For example, we find a mask-like entertainment even in The Tempest, right? Where we have Ferdinand and then Miranda, their marriage, and then those airy spirits, gods and goddesses coming and then blessing the couple, right? Similarly, here you find that the moment Anne Boleyn and then King Henry VIII, they marry, there as well we have this mask-like entertainment, right? Where, of course, the gratitude is expressed for a particular ruler. And similarly here, when Queen Elizabeth is born, mind you, there is a huge crowd which gathers there to actually have a look on Queen Elizabeth, not knowing, I'm not saying, they do not know at the time that it is she's going to become the greatest, one of the greatest monarchs, right? Because her rule gave that solid foundation to the British system of monarchy, right? It was her role when especially these religious controversies, they for the time being came to a standstill, right? So maybe Shakespeare wanted to make that gratitude, to pay that gratitude to Queen Elizabeth, or maybe to the Tudor rule, maybe to the Protestant rule as well, right? So that is again, that is another important concern of the play under question. And at the same time, the play was written in 1613 when it was the rule of King James I, right? So Shakespeare was, he was moving from Queen Elizabeth now. He brings in Queen Elizabeth, goes back to history, talks about what happened in history, and then how Protestant rule that in a way brought more stability and more peace to the English society. Now again, I'm not saying that there was complete peace, because there were many actually episodes wherein people, they were completely protesting against King Henry's VIII's decision of divorcing Queen Catherine, right? So they were acting against that. There was one particular incident which took place in 1536. I'll get back to that later. When there were these many people, many earls who stood against queen against King Henry VIII for actually letting that first stone be laid, for introducing Catholic rule in England. Although I'm not saying it was officially done, but then there were many things which I'll talk in my next lecture, right? So he was also catering, Shakespeare was also catering to the new mood which was there in England in 1613, right? And now next thing is that if you again, the joint authorship is there, that why Shakespeare does so and so. So Shakespeare deliberately avoids actually many stylistics which were there in his early plays. For example, if you look at it, there is no comic subplot, right, which can be found in history plays, especially when you look at Henry IV part 1 and Henry IV part 2, right? So in both these plays, we do find there is that character called Falstaff, right? Falstaff, whom Harold Bloom considers one of the central inventions of Shakespeare, and that is why Harold Bloom calls Shakespeare, actually why he happens to be at the center of the canon, right? So Harold Bloom, the famous critic, right? He gives central importance to that creation of Falstaff. But then in those plays we find there are many tavern scenes where that is the son of Henry IV, he is very very non-serious in the beginning, he likes to drink more, and similarly he enjoys the company of rogues, and then these low-class people are, that is Falstaff. But then, I mean, there is a comic subplot, but in Henry VIII we do not find such comic subplot, mind you. So he deliberately avoids those things here, right, friends? And if you look earlier, that citizen, as far as citizens are concerned, so the views of the citizens, they are ignored actually in, I'm not saying ignored, but then they do not figure as much prominently in other history plays as they do figure here. For example, here Queen Catherine, she likes very much the criticism of the taxes which are levied, which are imposed on, that is, common people as well as on the nobles, right? By not King Henry VIII exactly, but Cardinal Wolsey, because Cardinal Wolsey, he was doing certain things behind the back of King Henry VIII. So even here, citizens are made to voice their discontent against such a rule, right, friends? Next thing that we find here is that a crowd is not ignored even in the play, the way we find that crowd actually gathers in large number in Act 5. When Act 5 and last scene, fourth and fifth scene, when they want to have a look of the young baby, that is Queen Elizabeth, right? So somewhere they are also given a space here. But then if you look at for example in Richard II and Richard III, we do not find actually that people do provide such a commentary, right? They become such a part of the action of the play, right? Then friends, what does it show is that there was this increasing influence of court, right? Why? Because a Kingsman, the theatrical troupe that I was just referring to, this company, it was more closer to King James than it had been closer to other monarchs, for example even Elizabeth, right? So the Kingsmen, they became more closer to Shakespeare, James I, than they became to Queen Elizabeth, right? And the second thing that is that you find even such allusions to the monarch even in Macbeth or such plays as Measure for Measure, right, friends? other things which I consider important here, they have to do with that somewhere Shakespeare's early history plays, they were in a way dealing with the nature of monarchy, right? Of what kind monarchy should be, right? Of what kind a ruler should be. So we have seen that, for example, in Richard II, we have seen Richard II, how he does not like the idea that a ruler should be a devilish in nature. Devilish, by it I mean that one should be corrupt, one should impose taxes and then one should go on funding a war, especially the Irish war, which was taking place during the time of Richard II, right? In the year, in the 14th century, from 1377 to 1399, if I'm not mistaken, right? So he was talking about the king's weaknesses in Richard II. And here, when we are talking about here, so he does not here talk about what that he's talking about the education of a prince, for example, what kind of a prince should be. Or for example, Machiavelli's The Prince, it had also been written during those times as well, that in under what circumstances the people have right to actually depose a king, right? So he had thought over those issues earlier as well. But here, he was, purpose was that he was thinking more about how to dramatically express his gratitude. Gratitude to what? Gratitude to a particular ruling family, or gratitude to a particular ruling monarch. So we know Queen Elizabeth came earlier, I told you about this. Now there was James I, and there was stability, there was peace. Now the third other thing is that in this play you do not find, it is a history play, but then we do not find that any direct battle scenes, they take place here. So there are no direct battle scenes here, and since there are no dramatic these battle scenes, there will not be that so much oratory, right? Triumphant oratory, for example, the kind of oratory that we find in Julius Caesar, if you look at it, or we find in Richard II, or we find in Henry V or Henry IV part two especially, right? So there is not that, right? So it does not mean that it is not patriotic, right? I mean, talking about only battles is not a sign of patriotism, right? That is not the only criteria. That is what I mean to say here. So in a way, he was writing this play as a sort of you call it prayer, you call it thanksgiving rather, right? A sort of thanksgiving for such a rule that had been brought to